Coming up on Need to Know, the airport can be a temporary home for many travelers during the holiday season. While some of you may be stuck in long security lines waiting for connecting flights or to rebook canceled flights at this very moment, we're talking security measures and future plans at the Greater Rochester International Airport. Also on the program, he was listening to Beethoven at the age of 5. We learned the backstory of the music director for the Rochester Philharmonic Orchestra. And a local husband and wife art team discuss what they call the serendipitous nature of their work. Figurative and abstract collages that speak to the spirit of humankind. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. The holidays are now here. And with the influx of cheer, family time, tree chopping, gift shopping, office potlucks, and parties, among all the other staples of this time of year, we can't forget the travel portion of the holidays. During Thanksgiving alone, more than 20 million passengers are expected to fly in the U.S. during the 12-day Thanksgiving travel period. So, how have airports prepared themselves for the busy travel season in the midst of passenger concerns with issues like Ebola and other security risks? To learn how the Greater Rochester International Airport is positioned to take on these issues and more, I'm joined by Director of Aviation, Michael Giardino, and it's great to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
So you are a SUNY Brockport graduate.
I am.
A retired U.S. Navy commander. And prior to being appointed director of aviation about 3 years ago, you were the manager treasurer for the village of Brockport.
After retirement, yes.
So I'm certain that we've got viewers and they're watching right now and they're thinking, oh my gosh, he's done a lot and he looks so young. And I want to say this, I have to ask, was meteorologist ever a job that you considered? Because I read that you studied meteorology at Brockport. So I was curious to know, is it something that missed calling, or would you still be considered or interested in pursuing that?
Not as a career anymore, but it is still an interest, always been. And of course, in aviation, my meteorology background and my SUNY Brockport education was terrific in preparing me for that. But at one time, yes, meteorology was the goal.
Well, I have to believe that your varied background, it serves as a great guide in the work that you do as airport director. Your aviation background obviously plays a strong role, but you also, the work you do, you're running a business, and there are a lot of nitty-gritty details that accompany that task. So I want to know, how does your background help you wear the many hats that you have to wear?
Well, we are running a business, and in the Navy, people might not think about warfighting as a business, but it is. We had a lot of equipment to take care of. Maintenance costs and things like that. But most notably, at the end of my career, I was the second in command at the Naval Air Station in Key West, Florida. That facility encompassed just about everything that you could imagine. It was a small city. So we had facilities, which we have at the airport. We had retail businesses, a hotel, two marinas, 500 RV spots, as well as running a Naval Air Station with a port facility as well. So a wide variety of background there, and I was an analyst in the Pentagon, was there during 9/11, and 3 years as an analyst in the Pentagon in readiness accounts for the Navy, ship maintenance, aircraft maintenance, facility maintenance, manpower. It prepared me for my present position.
Well, from what I understand, and correct me if you're wrong, your role and the role of airport is that of landlord. And the airlines are the tenants, and if you would describe it like that. And I just want to know, what type of juggling is required to keep the airlines happy? And not only that, to keep the operating costs low so that fares can be at a low rate and therefore travelers are happy.
Yes, ideally, the landlord keeps the costs low for the tenant and the tenant wants to be there. And in turn, hopefully the tenant's costs are low, and that means more service in Rochester for us, and lower ticket prices. I mean, that's the bottom line. So we try to raise revenue on our own, which is parking, other concessions like rental cars, other concessions like food, beverage, and things like that, as well as being a landlord, we've got properties that we lease out to other entities as well. So we try to raise as much non-aeronautical revenue as possible, that's what we call it, to keep those costs low, because the airport is self-sustaining. There are no tax dollars except for the aviation grants that come from the federal system, which is based on how many passengers come through. The airport itself is self-sustaining. So the more revenue we raise, the less cost the airlines pay to be there. That's called their rates and charges, and hence the customer, hopefully, pays less at the ticket counter.
Oh, I can imagine. I can just picture trips to the grocery store for you and the number of people who must stop you on any given trip and say, can the airline rates go down? Or talk to me about why they aren't connecting, or why we can't have connecting flights or direct flights from Rochester to Tampa anymore, things of that nature. I have to imagine that you get asked a lot of questions like that, and some things are things that you might not have control over.
I do. And the things that we do have control over, like keeping those costs low and getting a lot of revenue from our parking, for example, I explain that. And as far as nonstops to other destinations, we explore that all the time. I can explain to passengers or people on the street that ask me questions, why don't we have a nonstop to a certain destination? And I can quote them the numbers, because we know how many passengers fly from Rochester to a destination. And of course, we know that some connect and some are nonstop. And for those that connect, the data is there to say you connect for a reason. There aren't enough people going there to warrant a nonstop. But where there are opportunities, we visit the airline planners, and I do that annually. And we actually go to the headquarters and we plead our case, if you will, and make a case for a nonstop that we think would be viable for them. Of course, we can't tell them about a nonstop to a destination that's that we're not going to get there,
right,
because of the numbers. But where we see opportunity, we go after it. And we also are open to other carriers coming into the airport and providing that service.
Let's talk a little bit about security. In the midterm election earlier this month, terrorism was one of the top issues for New York voters and voters across the U.S. I just want to know, how does your role fuse with TSA when it comes down to security, terrorism, health risks such as Ebola and other issues?
We partner with TSA. Of course, I'm the facility manager and landlord, as you described, but security on the airport is my responsibility. Our fence line and everything inside the fence line is airport, and we have to maintain those TSA guidelines. They're given guidelines. We have law enforcement. For us, it's the Monroe County Sheriff's Department. It is mandatory for us to provide law enforcement at the checkpoint, even though it's the TSA's checkpoint. It's the airport's responsibility to have law enforcement at the checkpoint. We also choose to have road patrols and have patrols inside the gate as well. So we are frequently patrolling all the areas to make sure that we're maintaining the standards set by Homeland Security, number one. And some of those are getting people off the curb, which doesn't make a whole lot of people happy. You can't wait at the curb. But we do offer a cell phone lot where people can wait. And on their smartphone, they could actually check our website and see when arriving flights are coming. So then they can go to the curb. So with all of this, we're integrated with the TSA. We work as a partner. In Rochester, we're fortunate. We have a contractor, and that's been that way since 2001. Since this was implemented, our consolidated checkpoint in the TSA, we've had a contractor instead of TSA in the checkpoint, and that's worked well for us as well. So we work as a team between the TSA, the airport, and the contractor, and Monroe County Sheriff's Department. We do pretty well.
And in terms of the holiday season right now, with busy, lots of traveling going on, in terms of that security, does it escalate? Is it more enforced, or is it rather stay the same?
Well, it's random,
okay.
And that's the way we like to keep it in the security world. And in my military career, I would say that as well. We don't want to be predictable, and so hopefully the bad guy doesn't know what we have available, and we have an array of things that we do and the TSA does that are even unbeknownst to me at certain times. And also, there are other law enforcement agencies that come to the airport. Customs Border comes to the airport. The New York State Police will come to the airport at random times, and that's the way we like it.
We've got about a minute left. And Michael, I want to know, what are your hopes for the Greater Rochester International Airport moving into 2015 and beyond? Is there anything you can tell us about a project or a plan that you're hoping to bring to the airport?
Well, the facility's terrific. Built a great place back in the late 80s, early 90s, and all that planning. And we're fortunate that the facility is great. But if we had a wish, it would be because of the TSA requirements and people have to get into the checkpoint to fly, that we would upgrade the terminal building to a destination. So inside, after you get through the checkpoint and before you board your airplane, we want to have better amenities for you so that you feel comfortable, you know you're going to make your flight, you spend a little money, hopefully, with us, and then and just make it a great place to be before you get on an airplane.
Michael Giardino, Director of the Aviation at the Greater Rochester International Airport. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. And for the latest on flight arrivals, departures, delays here in Rochester, go to monroecounty.gov/airportflights. Embracing the world of music began at a young age for Ward Stair. The music director of the Rochester Philharmonic Orchestra listened to all of Beethoven's symphonies when he was only 5 years old. And the first orchestra he ever heard live was none other than the RPO. It's quite obvious, Ward Stair is living his dream, but we'll let him tell you that for himself.
Music is very much a living, breathing thing. It's a wonderful thing. It's alive itself. When I was around 5 years old, I was listening to a recording that my father played. And it was kind of a fateful moment because he said, after he had explained what a record was and that it had sound and music on it, he said, would you like to hear one? And I said, yes. And he said, pick. And there was a wide variety, and my little finger happened to land on a Beethoven symphony. And I remember the sensations. I don't remember in great detail because I was 5 years old, but I do remember being captivated by the sounds and the landscape of sound in a classical symphony. And I actually listened to the entire symphony that day, and I asked for more later. So over the course of several weekends, I think I listened to all the Beethoven symphonies at 5 years old. The first orchestra that I ever heard live was the Rochester Philharmonic. So being here now as the music director is a little bit surreal for me because I remember sitting up in the loge up there many times with my family and watching. I remember fighting with my sister over the binoculars because we wanted to look at all our, you know, favorite sections and favorite instruments up close. I think it might have been my youth orchestra director who talked to me about it articulately, you know, for the first time, and sort of articulated what a conductor does. It was Dr. David Harmon. He was the youth orchestra director when I was in the Rochester Philharmonic Youth Orchestra. And then when I realized that, I thought, well, that's what I want to do. That's fantastic. I skipped a year in high school, went to Juilliard when I was 16 years old, and then when I was 18, actually, after halfway through my second year, I was appointed principal trombone of the Lyric Opera of Chicago. So I left school to go to Chicago when I was 18, and I started, just dove in, really, to the professional world. And I played there for six full seasons. And while I was in the orchestra, in the Lyric Opera Orchestra, I also subbed a lot with the Chicago Symphony and once with the New York Philharmonic, which was amazing. So I was playing with really great orchestras. But then I had time in the off season to really pursue my end goal and my main dream, which was to become a conductor. And my first conducting position was with the Los Angeles Philharmonic. I was the League of American Orchestras conducting fellow there when Esa-Pekka Salonen was music director. I did that for 1 year, and then I went to St. Louis, where the St. Louis Symphony hired me as their resident conductor. And I was there for four complete seasons, and I've been back many times as a regular guest since then. I've conducted a lot at the Lyric Opera Chicago and some in Europe and kind of all over the place. For the last 2 years, I've been really guest conducting, and so now it's wonderful to have a home base and have a fantastic orchestra of my own. I look forward to doing is interacting a little bit more directly with the community, I suppose. I don't want there to be any perception that we as classical musicians are unapproachable or up on some in some ivory tower or, you know, in a wax museum. I mean, we're very much accessible. I'd like to really increase our footprint in the community. I'd like to bring dynamic programming in the sense that we have something that the audience likes and is familiar with and will recognize, but also some new things. So we challenge the ears a little bit, but we have a thread of familiarity, so people are rewarded for coming to the hall and hearing a piece that they've known since their childhood. It's not just building the relationship with the orchestra, you're also building a relationship with the public. And so I look forward to doing that, and I want to have that interaction and that feeling of a connection with them.
This story was a collaboration between the City of Rochester's Communications Bureau and the WXXI television production team. And from connectivity through music to art, we transition now to a collaborative effort by the married duo Cheryl and Don Oney called Louise's Daughter. The Rochester-based art team creates mixed-media sculptures, wall pieces, and jewelry, primarily of three-dimensional figures with personalities of their own. They create characters intended to speak to the spirit within everyone, characters that celebrate and rejoice in life. To learn more about Louise's Daughter, I'm joined by the artists behind the brand, Cheryl and Don Oney, and it is great to have both of you here. Thank you. Great to be here. So Cheryl, prior to starting Louise's Daughter with Don, I understand you were a social worker.
I was. And
Don, you spent over two decades creating children's toys. You are a self-taught woodworker. You told me before, you said business was very lucrative. And so I'm really curious to know, all that being said, how did a social worker and a woodworker join forces and start Louise's Daughter? Tell me, when did the magic happen?
Well, the social worker, the magic stopped happening as a social worker, and I was going to take a rest. I was going to take a couple months, years or something off. Don said that was okay, but then when I actually resigned from my job, he said, you can't sit around here doing nothing. So he put me to work in the toy factory, which was not as much fun as people would think, working in a toy factory. But I got acquainted with materials, and I started playing around with paper and cutting out figures that kind of looked like people. And Don looked at them and said, these really need to be made out of wood. And that was the beginning of Louise's Daughter.
And I understand, I'm interested in learning the backstory of the name, because I understand it's inspired by your mother.
By my mom, Louise. Well, my mother was a really interesting person, and this little tiny person, about 4'11", 5 feet tall, said a lot, talked a lot, knew everybody, or it felt like that when I was a kid. I was a very quiet kid. And people would always look at me and they would say, now who are you? And I'd say, before I could even answer, they would say, oh yeah, we know, you're Louise's daughter. And hence the name.
I was Which 50. I get lots of questions about
I'm sure you do.
Don't look like Louise's daughter.
Because Louise is actually, there's a wonderful photograph of my mother that's actually our logo. And so after, we did not get started with this until after she died. But it made me begin to think about, you know, your mother died, you're turning 50. If you're going to do something else with your life and your time, why not now? And if not now, when? And that's where it came from.
Well, given the essence and the spirit of the pieces that you create, do you see her life emulated and that worked?
Oh, absolutely. I see her personality all over the place. And that's the one, that's one of the reasons that we carry around her photograph, that her memory is there. My dad was a wonderful guy too, and he taught me about real estate and he did a lot of things like that. But my mother was the connector with people always. And she was the PTA president, and she was the just very active neighbor, and she was an interesting person, like I said.
Well, you're known for these colorful three-dimensional collages of human figures, all shapes, all sizes, and when I stopped by the factory where the creativity takes place, and I saw figures dancing, cheering and celebrating, and I read in articles about both of you that these figures give off energy and personality to customers. So I wanted to know, how did these collages become your signature pieces?
Oh, I don't know.
We just started selling them to people and things. I guess what you talk about, people reacting. My favorite is when we're in the booth and you see little girls in particular, sometimes little boys will come in and they'll pose with the figures on the wall, and you just know the grown-ups usually a little more subtle, but the kids come in and just sort of immediately react. And of course, as a former toy maker, I respond to the kids responding to things. But yeah, everybody just likes them, enjoys them, feels like they'd like it in their house to make them happy, and that's what happens.
So. Responses to the spirit of the piece. We sell to people of every ethnic group, every personality, and we don't do faces. Right. And we don't do faces, one, because we don't know how to do faces, but the other part of it is, the bigger part of it is that we want people to respond to the spirit of the piece, and we want them to see themselves or their friends or their family or other people that they know. We want them to be able to place themselves in that piece. And if you put a face on it, then it automatically becomes someone in particular. And that seems to be working for us.
Well, quick story on the faces. The first piece that my granddaughter wanted me to make, we came to the shop, we cut things out with a laser. I was showing her how to do it. She wanted me to make a particular figure
she
knew about.
Okay.
And I maybe even younger than that. Anyway, she wanted a piece. We made it and took it home, and the first thing she did when she got home was get out one of her markers and put a face on it.
She
knew what face it needed, and right. So I right. think everybody knows what face it needs mm-hmm. for them, so mm-hmm. that's what happens. So.
Well, you both said before mm-hmm. that, this is a quote, that you work to make art, peace, joy, amends, and to live like we mean it. And you've also said your relationship and your work is serendipitous. So explain that, and in what ways?
Well, you know, we met by chance, and the work emerged by chance. But it seems to, it creates a warmth of the warmth that we have between us and also that we feel toward other people. And what I found is that we do a lot of craft shows kind of around the country. And what I find is that people come into our booth and they tell their own stories too. And also in the booth may be pictures of our grandchildren, pictures of when we first met, pictures of our wedding. So that sort of validates Don being in there with all those brown faces in the booth. And it feels like it's a way of connecting. And I think that people nowadays, with all of the social media and the you know, all of that stuff and all of the calling someplace and never getting a real person to talk to, I think people really are aching for that connection with one another in person, in real time. And that's the essence of what we do.
Well, Louise's daughter can be found in galleries around the country. And my mother's friend in St. Petersburg, Florida, stopped by and she said, I've seen the work at a shop in that city. You show your pieces, as you mentioned, and art shows also around the right. U.S. I think you show about every month, a few times a month at least.
Well, once a month.
Once a month.
Now that we're older, it used to be that, you know, a couple of times a month we'd be away out of town at some place. And now a lot of Don's time is taken up with caring for his dad, who is a feisty, incredible old guy. But, you know, when there's a crisis, he needs to have somebody around. And so basically, I'm the one who's out out of town doing shows, and so we've cut back on that. That I'm just not physically able. I'm old too. You
know? You've got grandkids to enjoy
as
well.
We've got grandkids, and our priorities are a bit different than they were.
Do you feel as though that you've reached this high in your career already, or is this journey that you're on? Do you find that you're constantly reassessing and setting new goals for yourselves?
Well, what do you think, honey?
reassessing how to downsize and still do cool stuff. I can't imagine not making things. I mean, yeah, I've made things since I was like 27 and figured out I could. And not making things just seems like not a good way to live life. But with, as Cheryl said, we're getting older. It's harder. It's more work. We're definitely got to continue making things and figuring out how to sell some stuff, because if you don't sell it, it piles up in the thing, and you got to, you know, we don't have a fireplace, so it's, you know.
So moving forward, it's for holiday seasons right now, moving forward into 2015, we got about a minute left. What are the plans for Louise's daughter?
Well, in January, we have a show coming up at the Episcopal Church home. It's called My Sister's Gallery. I'm doing a small thing with Mount Olivet Church to speak with a group of girls about the possibilities of making art or making things for a living.
In late January, you'll be at the Kennedy Center showing our stuff.
We do a trunk show in relation to Alvin Ailey Dance, and we're invited by the gift shop there. So.
Cheryl and Don Olney, the artist behind Louise's daughter, based here in Rochester. It's a pleasure to have you on the program. Thank you. And you can learn more about the Olneys and their craft. Check out their website, louisesdaughter.com. And that's it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Hélène Biandudi Hofer. Thanks for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend. And thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI.